Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Rocket Monday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at Skylon, the space plane. So let's dive right into it. So what is the idea? Idea is very simple. We want to achieve what's called single stage to orbit. This is the final goal. This is the holy grail of every space agency. So the idea of that is very simple. You don't do any staging. You don't drop off side boosters. You don't drop off your fuel tank. You don't drop off spent stages. It's just one thing that goes to orbit. That's it. Then we come to the fact, we also want it to be reusable, because if it's use and throw, it's really not that much, you know, benefit to us. So we want to be, reusable. And the whole idea of space plane is directly driven by the fact that we want to be using our runway based architecture rather than a launch pad based, because many of you know launch pads are very expensive. I mean, like, time on a launch pad is very expensive. You have to get license, permit and all that. Those are very expensive. And not to mention, launch pad is not even as common as runways. Runways are everywhere. Like, at some places you can have a runway like every 500-600 kilometer there might be one runway. And even a country as like India, you might have a runway every 1000 kilometers. So want to use the runway architecture rather than building a, you know, spaceport everywhere. So this Skylon idea is a brainchild of these three people. Now, before European Union started to create its own European Space Agency, UK used to have its own space program, and they were doing some good work. Now, once the politics got into it, let's just say it killed entire UK's leading edge into everything. Basically, every facet of technology suffered because of it. They used to be the one that, you know, could have almost broken the sound barrier. They lost that edge simply because of politics. Other things also happened. So UK was leading the edge, but politics got the better of it and destroyed everything. Not to mention, they were also building a rocket back in those days, the Black Arrow, commonly known as lipstick rocket, that could have competed with current Falcon 9. It was not reusable, but it was cheap enough. So as you can see, UK used to have its own dedicated space program. Now it still exists, but it's, you know, working under the subsidiary of European Space Agency. So this was the whole idea of UK itself. Basically, UK United Kingdom space program itself was building this idea. Now once that idea was scrapped because of politics, they also wanted to use a, you know, basically upgraded space shuttle. These three people who are working on that, one of them is a works in a Rolls-Royce. They three got together and basically they said, okay, we have to build this technology, the technology being used in Skylon. So they started their own company. The company is known as Reaction Engine. So this is basically a passion project, and the idea is very simple: reusable space program. And if you want to understand how far along it is in, you know, its R&D phase, the research has been done. What they need to do, that's been figured out. Now they are in testing phase, basically small scale test model, proof of concept model. So they are in that stage, but they are nowhere near, like, if you want to understand how far BFR is, I would say BFR is actually much further along in its development than these people are. And these are very small company, like they barely have 50-60 employee. So how does this whole idea of work, magical, you know, single stage to orbit and, you know, reusability, all of that relies on one core factor, one USP. That USP being synergetic air breathing rocket engine, or SABRE engine. Understand of it in this way: all it is just a rocket engine that breathes air like a jet engine. That's it. Now, why would you want to do that? So first thing you have to understand, mileage of everything like rocket or jet engine is measured in what we call specific impulse. Now, specific impulse of a rocket is very low. Like, best rocket you can only hope for as high as 600 seconds. Now, a jet engine, even a basic to good jet engine, can easily achieve 3,000 to 5,000. Some high mileage jet engines can go even higher. However, the military jet engines that are built for speed, they have lower specific impulse, but they still are at least 2 times to 5 times more efficient than rocket engine. That is the core principle. That is why they want to do it. Now, all things considered, they want to use hydrogen, and instead of carrying their own oxygen, they want to use atmospheric oxygen. Basically, they're gonna condense the atmosphere itself. Now, they will still have their own oxygen tank, but it will be much smaller. As you can see in this rough diagram, this whole orange thing or red thing that you can see is simply hydrogen, and one small blue tank is for oxygen. So if they were not, you know, breathing air from the environment, the oxygen tank would be much bigger. So they shrunk the oxygen tank to a very significant degree. And many of you have worked with high speed propellants or things of that nature, high speed basically equals high temperature. High temperature equals inefficient combustion. So if you have a jet engine that is like, you know, going at Mach 2 or Mach 3, the incoming air itself reaches very high temperature. Now, this SABRE engine is supposed to work at Mach 5, up to Mach 5, because at that point it will start to reach the edge of its air breathing mode, and then it will switch to internal liquid oxygen. Now, to make sure that engine works at that high temperature, like at Mach 5, the air intake temperature will reach as high as 1000 degrees Celsius, they're gonna do the magic. Now, this is the magic element, the pre-cooler. Now, this will cool the air that is coming in, that is coming at 1000 degrees Celsius. In split second, not even one whole second, in split second, it will cool that incoming 1000 degrees Celsius air to minus 150 degrees Celsius. Yes, 1000 degree to minus 150 degrees Celsius. So that kind of temperature drop will happen in this pre-cooler. This is the selling point. This is the unique element that they want to develop. So if that pre-cooler works, many of you know want to know how the heck that is, you know, extracting the heat. It's using what we call helium cycle. And basically, as many of you know, we have CFC and other things like that running in, you know, our refrigerators. Old refrigerator used to have that. Now you have many fancy concoction that is known as like R22, R25. So instead of those gases, they are using helium. Now, why would you want to use helium rather than hydrogen itself, given the fact that hydrogen is a cryogenic and it's almost to a, you know, close to absolute zero? Problem with hydrogen is that it causes what's called metal embrittlement. Basically, if you have thin enough metal lining and cold enough liquid hydrogen goes through it, yeah, it's gonna shatter it. And on a chemical level, this is not a, like a physical thing, it's on a chemical level. So it won't happen like, you know, it became too cold. It will happen because hydrogen kind of reacted, and helium, as many of you know, is inert. So helium makes a perfect refrigerant cycle on this. And using the helium, they will extract the heat, dump the heat that they have generated into liquid hydrogen. This is what they are developing. Everything else around it, that's like, you know, that's just add-on. This is the core technology. This is the patent that they are fighting for. Everything around it is the, you know, secret. Because if any company figures that out, if it works as advertised, it can change basically a lot of things. Because you can put that into your fighter jet engine and increase the lifespan of your jet engines. Because even if you have same jet engine, but if you can cool down the temperature, that is, you know, air temperature that is going into your engine, you can increase the lifespan. Not to manage, you can also increase the basically the speed, the longevity, and the mileage just by cooling the air that is going in. So this pre-cooler is the, you know, basically magic technology. So there are kind of complicated circuitry involved into this. The engine is so complex, it will make space shuttle engine look easy. So is there a problem with this kind of magical idea? Yes. The problem, first problem, is that even though it's super cooling the air, it is not dumping the heat that is, you know, that is collecting from that system into air itself. It's dumping that heat into super cooled fluid. Now this is a problem. Supercooled fluid, that's why they wanted to use hydrogen instead of kerosene. And as you can see, the consequence of that, hydrogen is a very low density fuel. This whole space plane basically is hydrogen itself. Yes, your oxygen tank is much smaller, but how much hydrogen you have to carry? Now, if they could have dumped this into, let's say, the heat that they're collecting, dumped into kerosene, this would be the size of kerosene tank and this will be the size of oxygen tank. That's it. This plane would have been much smaller. Now, problem with that is you can't dump that kind of heat, like, you know, gigawatts of heat that is being generated into kerosene. You know, it's gonna be vaporized. So either they have to use liquid hydrogen, or for commercial version that they, what they were also, you know, developing the technology, use liquid nitrogen. So basically it will be add-on to your engine, and every airport where you land, you have to refuel the liquid nitrogen. Or in case of rocket liquid hydrogen. So this is a very crucial aspect. It's not successfully able to dump that heat that it's collecting. So it's basically expending that heat using propellant. This is the limiting aspect of it. And it's not very capable. This plane design that came out, it's not very capable to come to understand its capability. It's more or less that similar to Falcon Heavy. Now many of you will be like, Falcon Heavy can do 60 ton. Now Falcon Heavy inherently in principle can do 60 ton, but the structural limitation of the, you know, very slim design that they have opted for limits them to very low tonnage. Basically, even though they can send it, even though their rocket is powerful enough, they will not put 60 ton on top. They will not put even 20 tons on top. So in practical sense, the capacity of these two are more or less same. Not Falcon 9 normal, although if they make Block 6, they may achieve it because it's barely 20% more than Falcon 9. Now, all things considered, this will still feel a very niche need, or like, you know, a very good technology. But the final nail in the coffin, why I don't think this will, you know, get off the ground, is needs 6 kilometer long runway. Space Shuttle was very infamous for the fact that it needed very long runway that was above 2 kilometer for safety reason. But this flat out needs 6 kilometer runway, and not to mention because it's firing a rocket engine and it's gonna pick up speed very quickly, it needs a very straight runway. Now you might be like, okay, all runways are straight. Yes and no. Especially runways that are have been in used in commercial, say you can fire a laser pointer from one end, it won't go to the other end, because wherever the plane lands, due to the impact force of that landing, that there becomes a dent. Now you can easily see, if you see any front compressed shot, basically a telephoto lens directly shooting from the front, you can easily see runways look like wavy runways, especially old ones. And you can even feel it while the plane is taking off. So they try to make it as straight as possible, but every time a plane lands, that's upwards of 100 to 300 tons of weight being, you know, impacted, it does collapse that area. So wherever you see that black patches, that's a generally down spot in your runway. So it cannot handle things like that because of the wing size. The wings are so small, it really needs very high speed. You can't do very high speed on a bumpy road. So the runway not only is very long, it also needs to be ludicrously precisely built. And suffice to say, that itself may end up costing more than anything else. And not to mention, you have to build 2-3 of these, you know, just act in case of emergency, because you can't land these on normal runways. So are there better designs that can allow us to do things that we want? The best design I could think of is Venture Star or X-33, on which you can check my video here, NASA's biggest mistake. And basically this has higher payload capacity than that, and it, instead of using runway, it directly goes from a launch pad. Now you might be like, okay, isn't that a bad thing? Yes, but it's good because while landing, because of it's basically what we call wing to body ratio, it can land on a very small runway. That is a crucial fact. It does not need ludicrously long runway or as long as basically Space Shuttle. It can land on very small runways. And because it's also going very directly up, it's also quicker. So if you want your satellite, let's say, have cryogenics into it, and you want to make sure, you know, it goes to space as quickly as possible, it will do the job very quickly. So all things considered, this is a much better approach to single stage to orbit than Skylon. However, Skylon Pre-cooler technology, if it works, it can revolutionize some serious industries. And let's talk about BFR. Now, because of politics involvement, BFR is much further along than any other thing that we are talking about here. So BFR might be ready by 2030, and that thing is hoping for a full scale test at 2030. And not to mention, Blue Origin is also working on a vehicle that will have more or less higher capacity than that and will be reusable. So all things considered, it's really not likely to happen that we ever gonna see a full stage, full scale working prototype of Skylon. That engine, that pre-cooler, if it works as advertised, of course that will revolutionize the world. But if it does not turn out to be as good as we hoped, yeah, I would not put my hope on it. So this was my presentation on Skylon. I hope you guys liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, dislike it. And if you enjoyed it, I would say leave a comment for what you want to see in the next episode. Subscribe, share it amongst your friends, and press the bell icon if you are free. And as always, thanks for watching.